Hello viewers, it has been a long time that I saw you the last. Sorry for that. But today, my gut feeling says that getting back in touch with you and connecting with you all again, it gives me a great feeling. You guys might have heard a lot of phrases that are attached to a gut. Gut instinct, gut it out, gut busting, gut wrenching. Have the guts and all sorts of things, those are directly related to gut. So what a gut exactly is, it is the entire tract from your mouth till your anus. And today, you might be wondering why I am talking so much about the gut. It is because today, we have a very interesting personality and a very accomplished scientist who is going to talk about his work and his experience going with the gut. So let's welcome Dr. Anand Kumar, who works in the biosecurity and public health group at Los Alamos National Laboratory. He is an entrepreneurial fellow under a joint initiative of the University of California and Los Alamos that helps early career scientists pursue commercialization of their technologies. So I would like to welcome Dr. Anand Kumar again, and thank you very much for taking time and sharing your research with us. And with that, I would like to request you to tell us more about yourself.
Thank you, Tripti. Thank you for the kind introduction. So myself, I am Anand Kumar. I am a staff scientist at the Los Alamos National Laboratory, as just Tripti mentioned. My background is I'm a veterinarian. So I got my veterinary degree from India. Then I went ahead and pursued my master degree in India. So it's called Animal Biotechnology. After that, I was a veterinary doctor in the Karnataka state for 3 years. Basically practicing small and large animal treatment, prevention, whatnot about that. But I have my gut feeling was towards doing a research. I came to US, I joined Ohio State University, and I did my master degree and PhD in Ohio State University. In my master degree, my research was focused on foodborne bacterial pathogenesis. While in PhD, I was more towards to study the human gut microbiome and probiotics, how they are beneficial to human being. So then I joined Los Alamos National Lab as a postdoc pursuing the human gut microbiome project. That in a minute I'm going to share how exciting that project was. Then recently, like last year back, I was promoted to staff scientist at the same division. So I am here to talk about my exciting project. It's called Going with a Gut, as Tripti mentioned. I also say this project as a really catchy word, poop to pill. So in a minute, I'm going to share my research, how exciting that was. Can I go ahead and share my?
Sure, we cannot wait to see the presentation. So please go ahead and share it.
Sorry, I think I have to maybe just a second. I have some technical glitch. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. So title is one of the exciting project. What I said is disrupting fecal transplant practice with a pill. What that mean? I'm going to tell you in a minute what is that meant. So you can tell that my project is to communicate to the really broad audience. It's a poop to pill. What does that mean? It sounds really like a catchy, right? So there is a bacterial infection called a C. difficile. It's also called Clostridium difficile infection that causes serious intestinal problem in human. In fact, in US alone, every year we report like a 500,000 cases, and of which 30,000 people die every year in US alone. And CDC report this pathogen as an urgent threat to public health. Biggest problem is once you get this infection, there is 33% chance that you're going to get infection again. That is, reoccurrence of this infection is really big deal. So I'm sure you are wondering, what is the treatment for recurrent C. diff infection? There is no standard treatment. Right now, even in the modern era of medicine, we don't have any standard treatment for this. So how do we are working with this treatment, these patients? There is a treatment called, it's very crude and a rough way of treating a patient called a fecal transplant. You can say a brutal way of treating a patient in the modern era of medicine. How they do it? Basically try to find a healthy donor and collect their poop, basically literally a poop, then give it to a patient. Amazingly, more than 95% of the patient recover. And there is no rocket science involved here. Basically, you collect a poop, make a slurry, and drag with the injection, and using an endoscopy, you inject into the patient intestine. That simple. You can tell, seriously, this is what we are doing in modern era of medicine. So it works fine. What is the big deal here? Like, what is the problem? There are a lot of risk and challenges associated with this treatment, because not many doctors and all hospitals can do this way, this procedure, because of the FDA regulation. And there is a bigger concern, is safety concern. We don't know what we are putting from a donor. There are some case reports saying that the patient will end up developing a chronic disorder, diabetes, obesity, and there is a mood elevation, depression, whatnot. You mentioned there are some unknown concerns associated long term. We don't know what will happen to the patient. Other problem is it's very hard to find a donor. Even though we apparently look healthy, all out of healthy patients, only 3 will be qualified as a donor. So that's very tough. And then there's a batch-to-batch variation, how effective the particular donor is. So there's again question mark. Bottom line is, this is not a universal treatment. We want to go with every patient. This is not going to happen. So to address this concern, we had a really exciting project here at the Los Alamos National Lab that I was heading. Our solution was, we use the same fecal transplant that has been used to treat the humans in collaboration with the University of Medical School in the UNM here. We get the same fecal sample that has been used to treat the patient. Then we extract all the microbes present in that, basically. Then among all, we identify only key microbes that bring about the effect, that bring about the cure. How about just use those microbes, key essential microbes, to treat the patient? That was our concept. Basically reducing from complex poop to a pill. You can call poop to pill. So by identifying that pill, we can reduce the invasiveness, because current approach is invasive. You have to go for an endoscopy. We can reduce the recurrence. We can reduce the hospital stay. We can reduce the cost, because it is just a pill. There is nothing associated with that. If you have a recurrence, then you can go and just take a pill. It can be used as a preventative, as a prophylactic measures as well as therapeutic measures. If you are a high risk, like a old individuals who take antibiotics are considered high risk for the C. diff infection, such individuals can be consuming these pills so that they can avoid getting C. diff infection. Or the patient who has C. diff infection, they can be taking their standard treatment along with this so that they can recover fast. That was our concept. Bigger challenge is, how do we do that exactly? So we developed a platform here in our division that we call as an UNHICEP platform, or microbiome screening platform. It has a lot of technical things, but I try to make it really like a broad, simple, simplified version where you can envision how it works. Basically, from C. diff patient, we get C. diff pathogens. From the donor fecal sample, we get the gut microbes, healthy gut microbes. Then we co-capture them in a tiny, tiny micro droplet and culture them in an optimal condition, that may be human gut. Then using your flow cytometry, out of millions micro droplet, we sort only micro droplet where C. diff pathogen did not grow, meaning that associated microbes likely has inhibited its growth. Then identity of those microbes will be revealed by sequencing. Since we sorted into a particular well, then we can use that isolate to prepare a pill, basically microbial pill that can prevent or treat the C. diff infection. So how long we went ahead? So we could able to demonstrate that we can capture them in a microdroplet. These are the some images in the like left-hand side of yours. You can see there are gut microbes and C. diff being captured in a tiny, tiny microdroplet. The scale here is 10 micron. It's very tiny. These microdroplet diameter ranges from like a 40 to 20 micron. That's very tiny microdroplet. And we did identify one optimal growth condition that can grow these complex microbiomes, because that was a very tough, challenging task. And right now we are trying to identify how to sort these microdroplets, which are inhibitory in nature. That's we are trying to collaborate because we have some technical challenges there. So basically we are trying to develop a pill that can replace a current crude way of treating a patient called fecal transplant. That was one of my exciting projects. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Would you like to stop sharing?
Sure.
Thank you very, very much for this interesting concept. And honestly, this is the first time I heard about poop transplant. Mm-hmm. It sounds gross, but I understand it is really an important technology where people are really recovering from their C. diff disease using this technology. Yeah. So I have only, please go ahead.
By the way, this poop transplant or a fecal transplant, it is not only just they are trying it on the C. diff patient, they are trying it on the cancer patient, they are trying it on the Alzheimer's patient, they are trying it on the obesity, diabetes. You just go and do Google, you will get a lot of literature search. In fact, we had one collaboration project with NASA where their envision is to take human to the deep space. One of the biggest challenges, when you go to the deep space for like a years together, space shuttle is a sterile environment. You drink sterile water, no microbes, sterile food, entire environment is sterile. So the way we live on the earth is we exchange microbes. We eat microbes, we drink microbes, we inhale microbes.
Yes.
When you go in the space for like a sterile environment, then it impacts your gut microbes. Means you will not going to get healthy microbes. For such astronauts, what is the concept is, they want to collect their fecal samples before going to journey, make them in the pill form. During the journey, they can inject, consume, maintain the healthy gut microbiome.
Right.
So what we are trying to do is, that's not a good idea. We can identify key microbes which are essential for the health of astronauts. Then you just make a pill that can be consumed by various astronauts, just for the, not the same astronaut.
Yeah.
That's the one of the project we are trying to pitch to the NASA and try to work with the NASA. That's fecal transplant is like really big deal. Since I'm from a veterinary background, this is also called a transformation in animals, where any animal who is really emaciated, what we do is we just take the ruminal content, intestinal content from healthy animal and put it to the weak animal. The animals recover fine. This has been going like in like almost 2000 years back. Mm-hmm. If you go back and track the record, Chinese medicine 2000 years back, there was a Chinese physician who used to treat the people who has a dysentery, diarrhea using the fecal sample. He used to call them a golden soup. So it has a long history, but now it has picked up really great in cancer treatment and C. diff infection.
Yeah, you just answered one of my three questions. I was about to ask, is this being applied to a lot of other diseases? Yeah. Mm-hmm. But you already answered. So my second question is, your technology of poop to pill, how close are you to bringing it to market? I saw your slide on where you stand, but how far are you technically and revenue-wise to get it to market?
Okay. So we have accomplished most of the technical things to come to very close, very, very close to get this pill. But one of the technical challenge was how to differentiate C. diff from the gut microbes in a microdroplet. Because when we saw it in a flow cytometry, we should be able to see the growth of the C. diff. Bigger problem with the C. diff is the anaerobes. And whenever we track with the fluorescent protein, which requires oxygen. So those protein don't work in the fluorescent, the tagging with the C. diff growth in a microdroplet. And antibody, so most of the commercial antibody cross-react with the gut microbes. That's not used. Third thing is using these specific peptide marker or probe. We tried all those options, but now we are trying to collaborate with some of the scientists who can engineer the C. diff, which can fluorescent, basically. When it fluorescents, then using a flow cytometry, we can see whether the microdroplet where C. diff is growing or not. If it is not growing, there is a less fluorescent, nothing, then you can sort and identify. If it is growing, you see bright fluorescent in the scatter plot, and you can able to see that. That's we are trying to collaborate, but that's the one of the difficult and very, like we stuck at that point, how to differentiate. But in fact, we applied same concept to the, there is another bacterial pathogen called MRSA, methicillin-resistant antibiotic, methicillin-resistant staph aureus infection, which causes skin infection in human, and it's a big problem. It's antibiotic resistance. We use same concept. Good thing with staph aureus is it loves the oxygen.
Yeah.
And using the same platform, we could able to identify a microbe that suppresses particular antibiotic resistance pathogen. We did not demonstrate such identified any pathogen which can suppress C. diff, but we identified microbes from our skin that suppresses another pathogen called antibiotic resistance pathogen. So basically, proof of concept we demonstrated for one other pathogen. For this, we need to get one technical, that's how do we tag the C. diff. If we get that, then downstream will be very easy. Identify microbe, then culture.
Yeah.
Then we have some connection. I try to explore who is the best partner, where we can scale up these microbe production. How do we pack them? If it is like a spore farmer, can we just produce spore and pack them in pill form? And in fact, like when I was an entrepreneur, I was trying to go to hospital and try to see whether the patient want to like a pill, they want to like a syrup, they want to like what. So basically, when I was trying to discuss this idea to them, they said, it doesn't matter whether you want to give me a pill, whether you want to, but I don't want to take a fecal. I'm ready to take a syrup. I'm ready to take a pill. I'm ready to take what you want, but definitely not the poop. So that was the reaction. So there's a lot of excitement here. We just need to get something get going. So we should be able to, once we identify, then we are looking for some pharma company collaboration or maybe taking this technology to other pathogen. And that's
right. What we are doing. Right. So you might not have an answer right now, or you might, would you like to share any insights when you're talking about fecal transplant? This is more related to bacterial diseases and transporting that selective bacteria to another person's body. Understanding the urgency of something that can kill COVID, can there be any sort of antiviral or antibody that can be produced or generated or already there in this fecal matter and can help recover or help people save from COVID-19?
I think you asked perfect question. In fact, we are putting a proposal for NIH, something of same thing. What we are trying to identify is, in the coronavirus, some people are asymptomatic. They don't get any symptoms.
Exactly.
Some have the mild symptoms. Some have severe symptoms. Some people die. Yes. Basically, we want to collect from each different people's asymptomatic, severe, mild, and all those people, fecal sample, and even the lung microbiome. Even the lung has a microbiome, its own micropopulation, and associate the categories to the microbes. What are the microbes? Can we pinpoint the certain microbes which can help to recover from the COVID infection much faster? That's one of the planning. So what we are trying to identify is what we assume is our hypothesis is people who recover quicker they have a specific set of microbes in our fecal sample, gut, or maybe in the lung. Gut and lung interact, crosstalk. Just like a gut-brain axis, there is a gut-lung axis too. Mm-hmm. So we want to identify such microbes. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, by identifying those microbes, can we use those microbes to give it to the patient who are succumbed to get a severe infection? By that way, they will be get a less severe infection, recur faster.
Yeah.
Good thing with these kind of approaches, these can be used along with the vaccine, along with the treatment. Basically, you are boosting the immunity of a person. Problem with the vaccine is if virus mutate, even antiviral drug mutate, then you don't have any immunity to that. You need to find again a newer vaccine, which take a lot of time and money. Unlike that, these microbes can be used whatever it may be, because it just stimulates your immune response and helps to recover very fast. That's the one of the project we are working with the Penn State Medical School, and we are very excited. We are collaborating with the physicians who can help us collecting the samples from COVID patient. We are going to do screening those microbes, then isolate. These are the downstream. So our plan is to put some proposal by end of October this year. We have written up. So that's very interesting question. That's we are wanted to get in that. In fact, there are some small startup company. They are also thinking in that direction.
Yes. That sounds fantastic. And we really learned a lot from you today. This was altogether a different area of research for me. So I'm sure my audience will love to watch this presentation, and I wish you all the best for your upcoming projects. And thank you very much again for your time. With that, I would like to thank all the viewers who have been supporting me all through my videos. So keep watching such exciting and educational videos. Thank you very much. Stay tuned, and please subscribe to my channel if you haven't yet. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.